Hey kids, it's time to get some SML podcast all up in that.
I can't wait for the 1 week where it's like, Kris, did you play that game for review? No, I was making Djent music to Tazon Day's looped voice. Okay, that works.
Oh, okay. That's a totally logical thing for a person to do. Like, okay.
Editing. What's up, everyone? This is the SML Podcast. I am your host, Joe. Joining me, as usual, Kris, CJ. How are you bastards doing?
I'm questioning my sanity.
Why?
Good.
Because of the song that I did today.
Now I want to hear you do a Djent version of Chocolate Rain.
Dude, it was a total, like, it was a flub. I have no intentions of, like, making music like that on a regular basis. Like, that was absolute nonsense.
Now you need the video of that, and you need to sync the video up with your music and make that on YouTube and wait for millions of hits to come in.
No. No. Because that, I'm waiting until I come up with that one idea and it comes out like perfect. And I'm like, this is it. This is the one that we're riding this to the top. We're going places.
This should be the one.
This is not the one.
I don't know, man. Tazon Day.
This is not the one.
For the people confused at what we're talking about, we'll announce one of the songs for this episode right now.
yeah, I guess. Yeah, shit. So none of that was recording before, so I have to kind of explain it again, right?
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay, so there's a video of Tazon Day, the guy that did Chocolate Rain, him streaming Team Fortress 2. And when he starts his stream, about like 9 or 10 seconds in, all of the audio of him speaking like restarts and starts like just playing on top of him talking again. And then it just keeps happening where there's like, I don't know, like 15 or 20 layers of his voice just on top of one another. And it just becomes absolute chaos. And in the comments of it, Mega Beardo ended up mentioning something about how this could potentially sound like a bonus track off of the Chaosphere Meshuggah album. And my brain was trying to process that. And then I started to hear it, and I completely wasted my entire afternoon making a guitar track and a drum track to put to this video. That's what I did today. And it's absolute madness and chaos. And yeah,
I think the main question to ask is, what's wrong with you?
I don't know. I really don't know. Like, there were plenty of times in making this where I just went, why am I doing this? Like it's kind of similar to when I sent you that one clip of like I was doing the shower with your dad simulator on the automaton. Like, I don't know why I did that. Like,
hey, Shower With Your Dad, that was going to be on your album, wasn't it?
It probably will be. Like, and it's stupid shit like this that I kind of want to toss on there too, just to be like, just to be an idiot. You know what I mean? Like I want to have like some songs that are really legit and a lot of fun and cool and stuff, and then just throw some of this shit in between, just to, like, just to mess with people, like. I don't know. I miss going to the ends of albums back in the 90s and trying to see if there was like extra shit on a track somewhere hidden that you couldn't normally hear. You know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about?
This last track is 27 minutes. There's something at the end.
Exactly. And this is the kind of stuff that I feel like would be waiting at the other, like at the end of the 27 seconds.
No, Paul saying a hidden track under the label, vinyl only. That'd be interesting.
Yeah, right.
Or what the fuck was it? The One Sister Machine Gun album. If you started track one and then held rewind, it would go to like negative 4 minutes and play their cover of a Door song, Strange Days.
That's cool.
It was a really good cover too.
Yeah. See, like, I don't know. Nobody appreciates like bonus tracks anymore in modern music. Cause
it's all digital. So you get everything the way it is. And now if someone sees just a track in the MP3 list, it's like, oh, this one's 15 minutes. Yeah. There's two songs there at least.
Yeah.
There's no discovery anymore. What CD was that? I think Burn. I think that was the album it was on. It was good, though.
But yeah.
Find that cover.
This is bonus track material.
System Machine Gun, Strange Days.
This isn't something that you need to, like, go out of your way to listen to.
This is your negative track.
Yeah, that's exactly what this is.
You should find a way to do that. Is there even a way, like, in a CD burning program to be like, yeah, I want to make this song track negative 3 minutes?
I think you could just mess with the... Yeah, I'm sure there's a way that you can, like, hide it in there where you would just have to reverse the track.
You know what I mean? I don't know how that shit works. But, CJ, how are you today?
Yeah.
We'll I'm tired after listening to that explanation.
Yeah.
Bitch.
I'm good though. I'm just jerking my girk to all these deals that I'm seeing that I wish I had the money for.
For those who are unaware, the Xbox Live Black Friday sales have unofficially started. They're supposed to start when we were recording tomorrow on Friday, but it is Thursday night and all the sales are pretty much up already. Most of them, at least. I know when Black Friday rolls around, they're going to have extra daily deals as well, but there's a lot of good stuff up for sale.
I want them.
I wish some of the prices were like slightly lower.
Certain games, sure, but
like,
there's some games that are really good deals out there. Right
well,
now.
Joe, like you said, Battlefield 1's going to be what, like 27, you said?
I think something like that. I know Titanfall is going to be 27 at Walmart, but they could go cheaper on physical because stores are trying to unload physical stock, where digital, you know, there's no stock.
Yeah, I suppose you're right. Like, I just hate having physical copies for games like that where I know I'm just going to like boot it up every once in a while.
Yeah. There's some good stuff on sale, though. Grow Up is $5. Live Lock's down to 14. Dangerous Golf is 10, which is, I fucking love that game. Necropolis is down to 20.
I want to get into Trials of the Blood Dragon. It's down to 750.
Rare Replay. Rare Replay is under $10.
Yeah, if you don't already have that, then you should get that.
And of course, Game of the Year, Pool Nation FX, 462.
I need to get Trials of the Blood Dragon.
I know. And Trackmania Turbo is down to 16, and Wolfenstein The New Order is down to 660. Oh my gosh. Metro Bundle with both of them are down to $6.
Siege is 40.
Yeah, that's ridiculous. The Metro Redux bundle. Jesus Christ.
The gold edition of Siege is 40.
Yeah.
Oh, Shadow Complex Remastered is 750. Let's just, you know, talk this entire list, right?
Honestly, if you don't own Saints Row 4 or Reelected, you have to own it now. It's $4.
Oh, God, yeah.
I think that is the cheapest game on the list as far as the sale goes.
No, Batman Telltale Series Episode 1 is completely free.
Okay, but that's not a price. That's free. I'm talking cheapest actual, like, purchase you'd have to make is Saints Row, I think is Saints Row 4. So far from the deals we've seen.
I know there's 360 stuff as well.
I don't see any of the 360 stuff on this list. That'd be interesting to see.
On true
achievements. Yeah, like Skate 3.
No, I'm looking at the thing that Noble.
I don't know what you're talking about, Chris. Skate 3.
Yeah.
By the way, let's get to the news. I was gonna like dilly dally on that and save that one for last, but Xbox One backward compatibility got a couple of updates in the past week with 6 new games added, and our speculation from last week's show was true, because yes, Chris, go ahead and announce it officially.
Skate 3 is backwards compatible on the Xbox One.
And I'm not at all surprised.
And I'm finally able to play Skate again.
And now on Reddit, every time new games are announced, there's some asshole in the comments going, "What about Skate 2? Fuck off. Like, really?
Why would they do that one now? With Skate 3, there's no point.
Some people.
I mean, Skate 3, like, out of all of them, I can understand why they did 3. If they don't get to 2 or 1, I understand. If they do get to them, I'm going to be fucking really excited. But they had their quirks.
Yeah.
They were great games, but I prefer 3 just because of, like, it was, like, the most polished of all of them.
True.
But then we got a Skate 4.
Maybe eventually. Maybe this will incentivize them to do so.
Maybe. But yeah, that wasn't the only game added. Also last week, Scary Girl was added. And then this week, the lineup this week just has me questioning why.
Okay, like, what is it?
Today they added Omega 5 and Military Madness Nectaris, which I'm sure are both decent enough games, just confusing additions.
I mean their whole plan is they would like it for every game to be backwards compatible at some point, so yeah. They're just adding more to the list just to pad the list.
No, I'm not hating on Military Madness, I'm just, I don't know, it's those are two games I actually don't own, so if they were cheaper than $10, I'd probably grab them. And then this past Tuesday they added the first two words will probably excite you: Dead Space, Ignition. Which is like the weird puzzle game that they released, which very confusing. And then
to go along with that, they throw on another sequel that nobody liked.
Fucking Escape from Dead Island.
Oh man.
I would actually like to try it one day. I have never played it.
I think I tweeted out, Escape from Dead Island is now compatible on the Xbox One. Xbox apologizes for the inconvenience.
Hey, but it's the only one that's not available on Xbox One, because you can buy the definitive editions of the other two.
Yeah.
So I guess that's why they did that one.
I think Escape from Dead Island
might... Are we going to talk about Dead Rising at all?
We could, yeah. What do you want?
Okay.
What do you want to talk about?
Well, I mean, just some of the stuff that they said that they changed. Like they did a stream. Let me see if I can find it. I feel like there was a report that I saw about it.
I know they removed co-op online from the game, which has a lot of people annoyed.
Oh my god! Did they? Nah, I'm not buying it now.
Well, fuck co-op that. Campaign. So
yeah,
it's
they're
going to
have like an online
player.
Yeah.
Fuck
yeah.
That. That's what those games were always fun for.
Yeah.
From 2 and up, it was always fun to play that. And now they're gonna fuck that. I'm not buying it.
So it honestly, it doesn't bother me that much because I never had people to play them co-op.
That's
with.
How I
think,
played those games. I've never just played them solo.
I think the most I did was I played like maybe an hour online with Rez on Dead Rising 2.
We played a little bit on 3.
Did we?
Yeah. Not long, but we played for a little bit.
Okay, well then I did it twice.
I've done that whole campaign twice in co-op for 3, and I've done most of Dead Rising 2 in co-op and then finished it solo.
Well, we should do Dead Rising 3 sometime. I never beat the game because it's like one of the changes they made in Dead Rising 4 that a lot of people are pissed about is that they removed the time constraints, which I'm
That's
thrilled
one thing
about.
I like.
I am thrilled about that because now I can actually play the game and do what I want.
I was never really a huge fan of the timer. It's just, it
I
wasn't
mean, I understand. Are they going to add it in as like another mode?
Yeah. It'll be DLC though, I think. People are bitching about it. It's like, the timer's what made it Dead Rising. Well, I really wanted to explore all of Dead Rising 3, and then it's like, the sun's about to go down, and a day is almost over. God damn it.
You have to make multiple playthroughs to actually do everything. One, to actually go through the story, and then a second one to actually do things that you want to do.
I just want to do shit in the game. I don't care about this. I just want to run over zombies in a fucking steamroller for 20 minutes.
You can do that. You just waste a lot of time.
For the multiplayer thing, like, are you going to be able to do any? Like, is it really just going to be free roam and that's it? Like,
I don't know. It's just not going to be like campaign.
Separated like missions that are only co-op that are like kind of their own thing.
Maybe
that'd be interesting, I guess. But
like, I want there to be like a reason to play online, because I feel like that's something that I would want from a newer Dead Rising.
Yeah, don't turn it into Watch Dogs, the first one, where there was no point in playing online.
How is 2? Did anybody get 2?
No,
not yet.
From the looks of it, the numbers too, nobody got 2. I'm joking. But it's not stellar. Not a lot of people grabbed it.
I actually read an article about it earlier today where someone said that they did with the second game what they should have done with the first one, and that you can't take it seriously. Like, they gave it more humor. Yeah, it's not just brown and gray. It's a more lively game, and it actually works a lot better that way.
Okay.
And they're saying it's a lot more enjoyable to play because it's not just such a dreary, drab, the world is terrible kind of thing. It's just it makes it feel more like a game again.
So almost like a GTA with hacking?
Possibly. I wouldn't say, no, Pulse. I wouldn't say they turned it into Saints Row, because you're not beating people up with dildos that I know of.
That you know of?
Yeah, that I know of. Speaking of dicks, tell me you guys watched the trailer for Genital Jousting today.
No, I did not.
No, but I know that there's a Let's Play that came out today.
You guys, right now, during the show, you need to find the trailer for Genital Jousting and watch it.
Oh, yeah, I will wait. Interesting, but
I will wait. I will wait, and I am working as hard as I can.
Can somebody get me a link?
God, you can just go to the Steam store.
Let me. Here,
I got a page link. I'm good. I got it. I'll send it. There you go. There's a Steam page store. You can see the trailer there.
Oh my god.
Oh, I've seen this game before. Yeah, I know what this is. Oh my gosh. What the fuck? You're just ramming dicks in
what online appears to be multiplayer ass. Games.
And there's a direct YouTube link as well in the chat. I'm sure people have seen footage of this game in the past. It's basically the game with dicks fucking each other.
Yeah.
What the fuck? This is ridiculous.
Links to trailers and video footage of the game has been circulating for a while, but it just officially released on Early Access. So the
Tell
trailer
me you were reviewing this.
I am trying. I got the email today. Let me see if I could pull up my reply to
what
it.
What the fuck?
Cuz I got the email to it, and I said I replied to the address. I'm like, "Hey, Joe from the SML podcast here, officially requesting keys for Genital Jousting so my co-host and I can rock out with our cocks out in some online action. Sounds like a fun game to dick around with. Hopefully our enthusiasm doesn't peter out after a few rounds, because this looks like something that won't just keep us busy for an hour or two. We could stay up all night."
Oh, God.
And the reply from the PR lady was just all caps. Ha, 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 ha.
But nothing else. No, don't do this to us.
That's ridiculous.
I also said, if anybody is available for an interview, our show is perfect for this game, and I think we could have an incredibly fun and inappropriate interview with the sick bastards who made this game, who made this filth.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I want nothing more than for our show to cover this and to get an interview with these guys. Like, I need this one to happen.
Well, every single year around Christmas, I try and find a game that I can gift out to people. This is only $5.
Is this going to be your Steam gift for the year?
This might be my Steam gift for the year.
And it's from the guys who made Broforce.
Funny thing, I just had Broforce gifted to me by a friend of mine from high school because he saw that it was on my wish list and he bought a pack.
Yeah.
Wow, how nice. Giving me one. I wish I had friends like that on Steam.
Dude, I hadn't talked to him since literally since high school. And he was just like, he had me added on Steam and saw that it was in my wish list. And I guess it went on sale for like really cheap for a 4-pack. And he didn't have anybody else that he knew that wanted the game, so he gave it to me.
And Joe, will That's you cool. still cover if I gift it to you and Kris? You're goddamn right I'll cover that one.
If it gets gifted to me, I will cover it.
And we will play online, Kris. You will need to make time so we could fuck each
we'll
other's dicks
yeah.
online.
Cause I do have to for science, I do have to see if it's worth
for science
gifting. Because when I do gift a game, it's got to be one that like comes across as like one that you absolutely don't want to play. But then if you do take the time to play it, it's not bad. You know what I mean?
No pulse. Me right. too. Hell yeah. We'll get everybody. You know, Sousa, pick up the game. Randall, pick up the game. CJ, you're broke, so whatever. let's get an online game. I think it's 8 players online. Let's just get a game going and we'll fuck each other's dicks.
This is fucking ridiculous.
I would not pay for that. I'd buy something else.
The game.
I wonder what the soundtrack's like.
Incredible. And a lot of people are like, I wonder if this would ever make it to con. I don't think this game will ever.
No way.
Make it
no.
to. Because no if, way. If it comes to console, it needs to be rated by the ESRB. And I don't see any way that this doesn't get an AO rating.
And Xbox is not allowed AO games on their platform.
I think any console maker would be a genius to be like, you know, we don't allow AO games, but we're going to partner with Devolver for this one. I think it'd be genius.
They would get flamed so hard.
And people would respect the shit out of them for it. But the game...
All right. The gaming community would respect the shit out of them. The general population would think that they're fucking monsters.
The general population
cannot be exposed to this level of filth that the nerd kingdom comes up with. You know what I mean? It's not appropriate.
Kris, you're going to have to whisper your Steam account to No Pulse.
Let's see.
Because I can't do whispering on this app that I'm using.
No worries.
we gotta get a game going. Seriously, Genital Jousting looks
amazing.
This is
so ridiculous.
But yeah, I'm goddamn. Oh, let's see. What other news do I have? The NES Mini released, and it immediately sold out everywhere.
Shocker.
Shocked. Anybody shocked? Units are listed on eBay for hundreds of dollars for a $60 item. Nintendo needs to knock this the fuck off. Like,
if anybody actually pays that much, they're fucking stupid. It'll just be back in stock in like a month.
Yeah.
If that. Just wait.
I tried to jump on Amazon because they sent out emails like, we're going to go live at 2 p.m. Pacific time, and we're going to have a limited stock, so make sure you're there and get yours early. 2 o'clock rolled around, I hit refresh, and wouldn't let me get it. I clicked on add to cart probably a half dozen times, different times, and it would go to my cart and it would be empty.
Yeah, I've heard other people that were having problems with that and bitching on Twitter because I couldn't buy it.
Yeah, and then the site just completely went down for an hour. Joe, fuck a dick, best wishes, No Pulse. Accept Genital Jousting? Yes, I will accept that gift. Add to my library. It is going down. This is gonna... Oh my lord, what the fuck?
We have to stream it.
Yeah, we're going to have to. We need to set up a play date for all of us to do this. This needs to happen. It absolutely needs to happen. Oh my god, Genital Jousting.
This is so ridiculous.
Have you guys seen the new commercial that Sony put out for the PS4?
Negative.
No.
It's like the King or something like that. It's a gorgeous looking commercial, another live action commercial of like, you've seen their commercials in the past where they would have people like reenacting scenes from games.
Yeah.
It's basically one of those again, and it starts off showing Call of Duty. Okay, makes sense because it's their big holiday commercial. And then it goes on to feature Horizon Zero Dawn.
Okay.
Which that's not out until the end of February.
Okay, I see the problem.
So
there.
For a holiday commercial, doesn't really make sense. But it's close enough. It's close enough, you know, get people hyped for the game. And then it shows Spider-Man, which is like next fall.
What?
And then it goes to God of War, which doesn't even have any kind of goddamn release window. And as far as I know, it's not even planned for next year. It's looking to be 2018. So for their big holiday commercial to drive attention to their console, they are showing one game that's out now.
That's ridiculous.
And two games that don't even have a fucking release date.
And it's available on multiple consoles.
Yeah, no pulse. Please await for greatness.
That's awesome.
I've been saying that for, you know, people have been saying, oh, this is going to be the year for the PS4. And it's like, next year is going to be the year for PS4. How many years has it been that people are saying this is going to be the year that all the big games come out for PS4? And they'll have a big one here. They'll have a big one there. But, you know, Microsoft, they're putting shit out. Look at their holiday commercial. Yeah. What are they showing in their holiday commercial? Gears of War 4, which is out. Forza Horizon 3, which is out. Battlefield 1, which is out. Multi-platform, but yes, it's, you know, Titanfall 2, which is multi-platform, but it's out. I mean, they're still showing exclusive stuff in there that's available now.
Did they not show ReCore?
I don't know. It's possible that... doesn't that PS3 game come out? I don't know. What PS3 game is coming out? Oh, Last Guardian. Yeah, that's not even in the commercial.
Fucking The Last Guardian. Because it probably sucks.
I mean, we've been saying I've been saying for how long since they showed it off at E3. Everyone was losing their goddamn minds over it. And I'm just like, yeah, it looks the same as it did 10 years ago.
I don't get the appeal. It's going to flop just as hard as Duke Nukem, waiting so long for a game that's...
I don't think it's going to flop, but I don't think it's going to review well.
Yeah, maybe that's what I mean. Like, I know the game will sell well.
There's still going to be
people that buy it. Oh, it's going to sell well. It's just not going to... I don't think it's going to be a very good game.
I think
when you take that long to develop, it loses it.
Yeah, and I think the fact that it's not in their holiday ad says a lot. Plus the fact that it's out in December after Black Friday.
Yeah, they're not... Well,
so was Dead Rising 4, though.
I don't know. Yeah,
there's still other games.
You're true. Dead Rising 4 is in December. I know South Park is in December. So it's not necessarily a death sentence.
South Park isn't in December.
Oh, no, that one got delayed. Sorry.
I was going to say, yo... Don't get my hopes up like that.
My bad. That's on me.
I can't wait to play that.
Mario Maker's December and Steep. Although I'm not hearing that much good about Steep, so.
Well, I'm not surprised. Did anybody really think Steep was going to succeed?
I think Ubisoft believes it's going to succeed.
I really don't see the appeal to a snowboarding skiing game, especially any. I mean, there's one that's coming out to PlayStation 4 that's free.
That was one that I
read. The one we talked about last week on the show?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And while you didn't think it was that great, you didn't think it was that bad either. And I don't think anybody's going to want to pay $60 over a free game.
True. I don't know. We'll see. I wasn't too impressed.
Talk about, I'll talk about that other game later as well. Yeah,
Mark McMorris Infinite Air. That's going to be one of our reviews.
True, that's another one just like it.
Well, I'll explain.
Yeah, we'll chat about that one later.
Right. Yeah.
Still a little bit more news. More bad news for PlayStation gamers, where unfortunately this one hurts me as well. Persona 5 has gotten yet another delay, which is a massive bummer. It was set for February 14th.
Didn't it have to do with like the English audio?
Well, I don't think it has to do with the audio. I think there were just like bugs and issues in it, but they're moving it from February 14th and to April 4th. And because of the delay, they are adding dual audio to the game. So that kind of, you know, it at least softens the blow a bit. It still sucks, but, you know.
I know a lot of people were anxiously waiting for that.
Yeah. But they also released a free dynamic theme on the PS4 for a day. So if you didn't get it yet, you missed out.
You already missed.
Pretty much. That's really did.
That's an interesting choice.
No Pulse is now playing Genital Jousting. Thank you, Steam, for letting me know.
Yeah, I just saw that too.
What's up to Xylo, who just joined the chat as well? Did you miss much? Yeah, you missed a lot, actually. We talked about Genital Jousting quite a bit. So you missed dicks. A lot of dicks. Which we've been talking about dicks for nearly four years now.
A little while. Yeah.
Toys R Us Canada may have accidentally revealed the price for the Nintendo Switch.
Oh?
Have you heard about this?
I have not.
You know how when people put up like a placeholder page for a game, they'll put like, oh, well, what's the price they have listed? Like $9.99, something stupid like that.
Okay.
You know, they'll always list something astronomically high so that a retailer doesn't have to honor a price if they priced it. You know, it's like, oh, they advertised it for $3.99 and it's going to be $4.99. People could throw a bitch fit like, you were saying it was $3.99, and the retailer will just cave and shit like that. They put up, Toys R Us Canada put up a placeholder page for the game with a price of $329.99 Canadian.
I saw that, yeah.
Which translates to about $249.99 American.
Wow, that translates much smaller than I thought it did.
Yeah, so, and that is a very realistic price, especially for a Nintendo platform.
They do try and keep their costs down,
but shit, man, like, how underpowered is this thing going to be then?
I don't know.
Yeah, now it's a little bit worrying about taking Elder Scrolls Skyrim remastered on the go.
I don't know. We'll find out. Again, we don't know any real details. All we know is stuff that's been rumored and leaked out. They're apparently saying that the battery life of the portable, when you use it portably,
is probably dog shit.
I think they're saying like maybe 3 hours.
Cool.
Not great, but okay.
But I mean, I can understand where this is supposed to be more of a home console with portability if need be. It's not supposed to be mainly a portable system.
Right.
As far as media, nothing has been really confirmed. I believe it's supposed to be like Vita-style cartridges, though.
Yeah, it's cartridges.
Yeah.
They showed that in the trailer.
I mean, that could always change, like, size and design, stuff like that. But
I mean, I don't care if I have to plug the thing in every once in a while, yeah. So be it. Like, but I'm just concerned more about the performance of something at that price point. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Really makes me think it's not going to be that powerful.
I don't know. We'll see. 2 months away from more details, so we'll find out more. It's very possible that, you know, it might not be as powerful as people are expecting, but it might be just powerful enough.
Yeah, but if it's just powerful enough, is it just going to end up getting left behind with the previous?
I mean, let's not forget like that Xbox Ones now are only $249.
Yeah, I mean, that's true, but
so, I mean, you know, the current consoles are getting cheaper and cheaper, and the fact that Nintendo's just coming in later, I mean, it's very possible that they could have the same or comparable tech into the smaller device. I mean, I would imagine that the screen might not cost that much, depending on the quality and everything else. I don't know. It's still a wait and see kind of deal. I think I'm still interested, at least. So,
I mean, it's still an interesting
idea. I'm interested as well, but it just makes me cautious.
Which That's is all. Fair. People are saying, like, oh, well, what if it doesn't have, the third-party games aren't that good? And let's be honest, not many people buy Nintendo systems for third-party games.
No, of course not.
So, it's because there's never any that are good that release, though.
Yeah, there are
decent
ones. They just get overlooked by all the negativity of people out there, like, there's no good third-party.
Yeah. Basically, exactly like that.
But some more Nintendo news. Pokemon Sun and Moon leaked out a couple weeks ago. Have you heard about that?
No.
Nope.
Yeah, there was a leaked version that was on the torrent sites and on the internets. And for the first time, Nintendo actually did something about it. People who got that unauthorized code and for some stupid fucking reason decided to play it online, their systems got banned completely from the internet.
That's fantastic.
Including accessing the eShop. So if you've had digital purchases, you got fucked.
Yeah, you kind of deserve it.
Yeah.
If you're trying to rip games. Like, just pay for it. It's like, what, $20 for new Pokemon games?
40.
Well, like 40.
Oh, well, okay, that's more expensive.
Yeah, but even still, 40, like, $40 for a new game nowadays, like, that's...
Yeah, but it's Pokemon. There's not...
Pokemans?
Either way, there's no reason to try to steal it on the internet.
Yeah, that's dumb.
There were people saying, like, I just needed to play it. I couldn't wait any longer, and now I'm banned forever. I'm never buying a Nintendo product again. Good, you fucking pirated the game, so they're probably not sad to lose you.
Basically.
Yep. So. You're not making them any more money anyway. You're banned from the e-store. You can't spend it anymore.
Genital jousting is $5. That's the baseline for pricing now. Oh man, that's how I'm going to describe all the games that we review this week. It's like, this game is $9.99 or two genital joustings.
Wow. I'm going to boot it up.
I'm happy to see Nintendo finally taking a stand and banning some motherfuckers.
Oh, they should. They should.
And then, have you guys followed up with this, the SAG-AFTRA strike, like the voice actor strike going on?
No.
There is a union, a voice actor union, that is on strike from video games. They're trying to work out some kind of arrangements so that the voice actors, they have better pay, they have better hours, like especially for more vocally demanding sessions, that they don't have to work extended hours, which is understandable. I think the wanting like profit sharing might be a bit much, because not many people buy video games for the voices. It's not like a mainstream movie where, oh yeah, I'm going to see this movie because Ryan Reynolds is in it.
That's true.
You know, you don't really buy a video game because, oh man, I need this game because Phil LaMarr is voicing the character. That doesn't happen. Let's
didn't
be fair.
A lot of the spark from remasters getting released and they didn't receive anything for their voices being in the remasters?
I don't know. Shit like that is stupid. Like, that should not be happening.
I heard that's what happened with Skyrim Remastered. Is that none of the voice actors actually got any more money because it's the same audio clips.
Yeah, that's kind of shitty. But, people who think that they demand, like, a share of the... You know, like they deserve lump payments if a game makes so many sales. I think that's asking a bit much. I think if you're reusing it in new releases,
they should just be paid what they're supposed to be paid for their job to do it.
But
there shouldn't be any like profit sharing.
But the strike has actually led to a list of games coming out that are being affected by the strike. And the list includes a couple of games that have some, you know, like project working titles and code names with some interesting information on there. Like something called the Call of Duty Stronghold in Lethal Combat or Skylander 6.
That actually sounds... That Call of Duty game sounds kind of like a strategy game. That would be pretty cool to see a Call of Duty strategy game.
Yeah, there's...
I think I'd be down to play that.
There is an untitled Marvel game with Telltale Games that was actually revealed to be Guardians of the Galaxy. Telltale Guardians of the Galaxy.
I didn't hear about that.
Batman Arkham Underworld.
So they're continuing that series. So.
Yeah. Lego Zeus. And then there's a there's a handful of Warner Brothers games that just have the code names of Kraken, Sabbath, and Metallica.
What?
Yeah.
If those are just Rock Band DLCs.
Well, it's Warner Brothers. That has nothing to do with Rock Band.
I was joking.
That's weird.
Yeah.
Hey, Kraken could just be evolved too.
Could be.
I'm joking. They're not going to do that. They're definitely not going to do that.
What the fuck?
Yeah, I don't know. It's all code names or
code names.
Walking I'm trying Dead to ponder season guesses, 3. But I can't make it an educated guess of what I would think it would be.
Who the hell is literally lining up to purchase Lego Zeus though?
I don't know.
People.
I mean, this doesn't mean people are lining up for him. These are just games that are in the works or have code names in the works.
I suppose it would just be, I'd hope it's a code name that's just Zeus is just, they don't want to reveal what the actual Lego game is yet.
Very possible.
Because nobody's going to buy a fucking game with Lego Zeus.
I mean, for Electronic Arts, there's Project X, Project X2, Walrus, and Yuma. So there's a lot of just code names.
Bullshit here. That nobody can really tell.
But
they're planning a sequel for X, whatever that is.
Actually, X2 is apparently Mass Effect 4. So.
Or what? Mass Effect 4, or is it Andromeda?
I would assume Andromeda. But.
I would hope so. Why did they do that anyway? Like every other game had just a number. Why didn't they just go with 4 instead of Andromeda?
Because they want it to be a whole new series instead of people expecting it to continue on from the end of 3. I don't know.
Yeah, I suppose.
But
I still should play those games so I can figure out the endings.
Yeah, that's all the news I got. Anyone else got anything to chit-chat about?
Not particularly.
I mean, Overwatch and NBA 2K17 are free to play this weekend.
Cool.
That's about it. Yeah. I mean, not really.
Cool.
Yeah.
You guys want to give away a game?
Yeah, sure.
Sure.
We have 2 copies of Gas Guzzlers Extreme to give away.
Guzzlers.
I bet plenty of peoples have entered that.
Yes, we have, I believe, 7 entries, something like that. No, Xylo, you don't type raffle. Yes, you silly bitch. let us start off with Ayan Khan, who says, I went on Twitter and I said, if you want to enter, you have to send us a road trip story. Not just telling us why you want a game. You had to give us a road trip story to mix things up a bit. So let's start off with Ayan Khan, who says, our trip wasn't exactly the most enjoyable of such. We'd all piled into the car ready for the vacation of a lifetime. I'd been forced to sit next to my 2 rat-like little brothers because I couldn't be strapped to the roof. The trip was already off to a bad start. The car started and we buckled our seatbelts. Dad started to back out of the driveway before we heard a loud crash. He stopped abruptly and left us all leaning forwards in our seats with our seatbelts choking us. Dad stepped out to investigate. When he hopped back in, he sat back down in the car. The mail will have troubles getting here now, he joked. We didn't laugh. He'd run over the mailbox. Dad made a few calls, managed to get his mate to come and fix it up while we were on vacation. So who wants to finally go on vacation? Mom asked cheerfully. We stared at her bored. The car started again. And we were finally on our way. About 5 minutes into the drive, we were seriously getting bored. So Mom and Dad kept put on some sing-along music and started to sing really loudly. They wanted us to join in, but we were resistant. Then my rat-like brothers started to play into the story. Dylan on my left flicked Corey's ear on my right, which made Corey attempt to kick Dylan. He missed, though, and got me in the shin. I yelled. Mom asked not to yell, which made me yell at her. By now, there was a full-fledged war between my brothers, and they were flinging themselves all over the backseat in an attempt to hurt the other. Because of that little display of our maturity, Mom and Dad pulled over, gave us a huge lecture on behaving while Dad was driving. We finally got to our holiday destination. While we were stretching our stiff limbs, Mom sheepishly came out from behind the car and said to Dad, "Bob, we forgot the luggage."
Oh, this sounds like the worst. I feel bad.
I swear China heard his scream.
God damn.
That was a kind of okay up until that last line.
That sucks.
Oh my god. Next email is from DJ Infine, who says, "Hi, my English is not so good that I can tell you a very awesome road trip story. Okay, I try it. At the age of 18, I had a very great trip to Lloret de Mar in Spain. And in my birthday night, I was so drunk that my friends brought me to a hotel room. As I sleep, they make my hair blonde and put a big woman in my bed." Oh, my God.
This sounds
great. Big woman.
The next morning, I become the biggest shock in my life. A big woman in my bed and blonde hair. Oh, my God. Sorry, but my English is not very good. I hope that's enough. Best regards, Robert.
It sounds great because when you say that his English isn't great, it sounds great.
It makes it that much better. Holy shit. Oh, my God. It's just... I really appreciate some of the entries that we get sometimes.
I know. Really, I love it.
Unexpected big woman.
And your hair's dyed blonde.
So God damn, man. You wake up with blonde hair and a big girl in your bed, which, hey, could have been a good night. You never know.
Yeah, that's true.
Next email is from Thomas Rodriguez, who says, "Hey there, my name is Thomas. I'm from Argentina, and I do my best road trip with my brother. I take a flight from Buenos Aires to Atlanta, 4 hours in the airport, boring, and from Atlanta to San Francisco, 1 week in San Francisco, then rent a car, Mustang, beautiful car, and we take the road to Los Angeles. Yes, all the trip in a car. 1 week in LA, and then we take a flight to Las Vegas for another week of fun, and that's it. 3 weeks of fun with my brother, and we came back to Argentina. We miss our country." See, they don't all have to be embarrassing stories.
But they also didn't tell us anything about what they did.
They got to drive a Mustang.
Seriously, I got to ride a fucking Mustang. That's pretty awesome. Just a cool road trip with his brother. See, they don't all need to be embarrassing.
40% of that trip was not on the road, damn it.
Doesn't mean you'll win, but they don't all have to be embarrassing.
That's true.
Next from Aroto Domedo, who says, "I don't drive, so I always take the bus. In one of these trips, I had the company of a couple of friends, and one of those friends brought a weird individual with him. On the first stop, the weird guy, let's just call him Edward. Edward decided he was thirsty, so he bought a big cup of orange juice. The juice itself didn't look very good or colorful, kind of pale, really. Anyhow, he was still drinking it on the way back, and we sat on the far end of the bus, me, my two friends, and Edward. A couple of minutes there, the bus back on the road, Edward decided he wasn't thirsty anymore. Keep in mind, his cup of orange juice was still 89% there, so he held the cup high as he could, pondering the possibilities. That's when Edward had an idea." Oh, God. He looked through the window and saw a big guy driving a motorbike. Oh, Jesus. Right behind the bus. Edward, in all of his brilliance or lack thereof, looked at us. Can't talk for the others, but my expression was a huge no, 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 no. And then proceeded to open the window and put half of his body outside with the cup. of 89% undrinked orange juice looking liquid. Edward, with the biggest shit-eating grin I've ever seen, looked at the motorbike driver, who gave him the finger and nodded his head in disapproval. The driver also had a brilliant idea, more prudent than Edward's at least. He decided it was a good time to accelerate and go past the bus. And so he did, and so he survived, but unfortunately a parked car nearby wasn't so lucky. If only that vehicle had a conscience, he'd have known the trouble that his owner would have had to go through to clean all that sugar and weird-looking orange stuff. But a car is only a car, with no AI. He stood there and received the orange bomb straight to the face. The splat was enormous, like a tsunami of cheap orange juice, which it was. In the aftermath, Edward laughed, proud of his work, and we, well, we just sat there, and the only words whispered were, "Never bring him again."
I could agree with that.
What a jerk.
He's a prick. I hate him.
What a jerk.
Edward. Fucking Edward.
What a jerk.
All right. Next one is from Agbavna, who actually tweeted us earlier and said, "Hey, did you announce a winner yet? I didn't get an email saying thank you for your entry, but you didn't win yet." Hi, the game looks amazing. A mashup of Carmageddon and Interstate 76. Good old DOS era. My best, well, certainly not the best when it happened, road trip would be during university. We were traveling by car to a seaside town during the night, stopped for a bite on the motorway. After the meal, went back to the car to realize we left the keys inside. Unfortunately, couldn't break the window because it was my friend's dad's car. Got a ride from someone and spent 2 hours looking for a locksmith in a nearby town. Finally got in the car and back on the road, making a pact to never ever stop for food on the road.
Lost keys.
No, they weren't lost. They weren't lost. They were just locked in the car.
They were just where they didn't want them to be.
Yeah. Next email from Nathan Ashton. "Hey guys, just want to say thanks for the chance before I start my own story. Anyway, enjoy." So myself and four high school friends, now grown up and adults, do a yearly road trip down to Myrtle Beach. Usually involves a week of shenanigans that leave us with tons of good memories. Last year's road trip was by far the best. We usually take turns driving to keep everyone happy and not killing us. Driving is cheaper and a better time, in my opinion, anyway. So we tend to pull pranks on one another while on the drive down. Anything from hiding the car while someone used the bathroom at rest stops, thinking we left them behind, or scaring the crap out of them when they finally fall asleep. Stupid things like that. Well, we finally make it down and everything, blah, blah, blah. The best memory had of the last trip we took was, number one, after a heavy night of drinking, we trapped one of our friends in his bed by combining all of our blankets and, in a way, tying him down to his bed for the night until the next day. Bad idea. We kind of forgot about him until after our free breakfast down in the lobby, well past 11 a.m. Needless to say, he was quite pissed. Get it?
That sucks.
He pissed himself. I know it's nothing too crazy, but to have friends from high school still to hang out with and have a good time, and making lifelong memories makes these road trips something to talk about for a long time. Thanks again. Friend tied and pissed.
That sucks. That really sucks. Yeah.
I'd be pissed too.
Final email from Daniel N. "Went on a family road trip to Yellowstone back in 2007. My uncle decides to splash acidic water on his face, calling it refreshing. We told him it was not a good idea. He did it anyway. His face turned ashy white. There was a story that came out today about a man that completely dissolved by soaking in acidic water in a Yellowstone hot pool. Story is giving me nightmares, but it's reminiscent of my uncle back in Yellowstone." And then he linked a story of the time link of the man who dissolved.
I just heard about that.
Oh my God. So those are our entries. We have Forgot Luggage, Big Woman Blonde Hair, Cool Road Trip with Brother, Edward in the Orange Juice, Locked Keys in the Car, Friend Tied Up and Pissed Himself, and Ashy Face. We got two codes.
An Oregon man who died back in June after
What are you leaning towards?
I like Big Hair, or Blonde Hair, Big Woman.
The blind.
Yeah, I like that one too.
That one was funny.
Yeah, I generally vote for the funny ones, and I enjoyed that.
And then I honestly kind of like the pulling over for food and locking your keys in the car, because that's such a realistic story. Like, that happens to fucking everybody.
Who the fuck is stupid enough to lock their keys in their car?
Everyone.
Literally everybody in the world.
Everyone.
Well, that's never happened.
How old are you? That's because you're 12.
I'm 18. Okay, so I've never locked, but my family telling you right now,
dude, trust me. I said that same thing. I said the same thing. I'm like, I'm never going to be dumb enough to lock my keys in my car. It's happened once.
Yeah.
Granted, it was happens. Only once, but it has happened. It is inevitable. You will do it.
Edward's story was funny. The orange juice.
See, that guy's just being a dick.
Yeah.
That guy's just being
an
asshole.
But I know people like that.
Randall locked his keys in the car. Here's a fun story. Pappy, we went to the Bloomsburg Fair, and he locked his keys in the car while it was running.
Whoa! Wait, how do you do that? That's pretty dumb.
By being a genius, I guess.
That's pretty dumb. It will happen. It's inevitable.
Anyone else have any thoughts or opinions?
I think blonde hair, big woman. I'm okay with that one.
I'm definitely
trying to
down
figure
with
out
that.
Who I want to vote for the second one though.
Aeon is also like for me, because I'm younger and I have siblings. I know exactly that experience of annoying siblings that are younger, and so that kind of just hits home.
Yeah, that one did suck.
I went to see Metallica, and my cousin locked his keys in the car. We missed the opener for that show waiting to get his keys back. See, fucking everybody has locked their keys.
Hold on. Who was the opener? Because I've had things like that happen before, too, at concerts, and it really depends on who the opener is.
True.
You might have gotten lucky.
Yeah. I've actually, that has happened to me before. I have missed part of a concert because it was like some band that I could give two fucks about that I didn't know was on the bill.
Give me a minute. I got the ticket.
That's great. I don't know. I'm down for whatever for the second one. I'm open. There was a couple that I liked, but I'm okay with going with the consensus. Right,
let's ask the chat then. Forgotten luggage or lock the keys in the car?
I feel like everybody's going to go with the keys because they have that experience.
Hey, that's the fair way to do it. Kris doesn't have an opinion. You like the luggage story, and I like the lock keys.
I think the fairest way is to flip a coin, but I mean, you can't.
Keys.
I don't have a coin.
Keys, luggage.
Forgotten luggage.
God damn it.
Just if you have a coin, just yeah, exactly. No plus just hates me.
Well, fuck it. I got a coin here, so.
All right.
Heads is forgotten luggage. Tails is lock keys.
All right.
Tails, keys. So
keys.
Ag, your losing streak has ended. You are getting a copy, along with DJ Infine. I always feel bad when someone loses on a coin flip, but
but that's actually
the universe
most
decided.
Fair.
It wasn't us.
Yeah, exactly.
Universe it's
the
decided.
Most fair.
It wasn't us.
Because it's just random chance. Yep.
But thank you to everybody for sending in your stories. We're going to have like a lot of fucking games to give away coming up. So definitely.
I'm a little bit surprised that nobody just sent in an email saying like why they wanted the game because they didn't pay attention.
I'm actually happy that they didn't. That makes me happy.
Yeah, right?
They paid attention.
I guess.
So.
It's a good thing.
All right, let's get to some reviews. Kris, I'm not letting you go first because Kris did his review and you laughed on that. So we got to make believe that you were here for the whole thing.
Sure.
Kris, it was Alice in Chains, Candlebox, Suicidal Tendencies, Metallica. Damn.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to miss any of that. Fuck. That sucks that you missed that. That's unfortunate.
Today is Ag Day. He won two codes. Nice. Rock on for
talk
him.
Talk about winning streak now. Fucking turn it around. Too lucky.
Well, hey, I know he's entered a few of ours, and I don't think he's won any from us. So rock on. First game to talk about today is called Ittle Dew 2, developed by Ludosity, published by Nicalis. By the way, it is Nicalis, not Nicalis or Nicalis. It is Nicalis.
Oh, so you finally figured it out.
Yes. The Ryan from Nicalis informed me. He's like, oh, by the way, this is how it's pronounced. Like, all right, awesome. Cool. Released November 15th for $19.99. Ittle and Tipsy crash onto yet another island filled with loot puzzles and mysterious inhabitants. With the help of a magical map, they set out to steal 8 pieces of a raft from increasingly improbable locations, including beaches, prairies, an art exhibit in some dude's basement. This game is fucking awesome. When I first saw it, I saw the art style. I never played the first one. Apparently, it was like a PC only thing. When I got the email about it, I saw the art style. I'm like, this looks kind of weird. Like it wasn't what I expected from Nicalis. Like they have more of a serious ish vibe to them, I guess. And this looked like it was drawn by a kid from Still Images. In motion, the game looks gorgeous. It looks like a playable cartoon. Gameplay-wise, it's basically like top-down Legend of Zelda-style game. Explore the overworld, hit up the dungeons, clear them, get new items along the way, and, defeat all the bosses, get a raft, and get off the island. Fairly straight and to the point. There are dozens upon dozens of various caves and areas to explore and hidden areas to find. And the amount of stuff to do in this game is insane. When I first started playing it, I didn't think it was going to be that long of a game because within the first 10 minutes, you could beat the first dungeon. Like it seemed like it was just going to be a really quick game, but for how big the overworld is and how much there is to do, like, it is deceptively long. I was surprised at how big the game was. There are some issues that I have with the game. For as kid-friendly as it looks, the game gets fairly difficult as you progress through it. Enemies seem to do more damage to you, but there's not... Like, I don't know if I'm missing it, if I didn't explore enough... I'm about to go on the sixth, or no, I'm in the sixth dungeon, and I haven't found any, like, armor upgrades.
Huh.
So, you can find ways to increase your life in the game by finding crayons, kind of like the pieces of heart in Zelda. For every one you find, it gives you a quarter of a heart. So you can increase your life, but it seems like, the enemies just do more and more damage, but there's no way to reduce how much it is. So it can get a bit frustrating where enemies are just wiping you out in like 2 or 3 hits sometimes.
That sucks.
Yeah. The game itself it's an absolute blast. I have been hopelessly addicted to it, just exploring every cave I come across, finding every secret I could come across. Achievement people, you're going to be disappointed to know that there is currently a glitched achievement, which hopefully they get that fixed sooner or later. The $20...
Just a little bit of foreshadowing. Not the only one tonight.
Nifty. $20 price tag. At first, I thought it might be a little bit high, but the more I've played it and the further I've gotten in the game and how big the game is, it is absolutely worth the $20. The game is gorgeous. It is funny. The music is ridiculously good. The composer actually has a handful of the songs up on a SoundCloud page, and I grabbed them, so I'm going to play some of those at the end of the show, along with Kris and Tazonde.
Oh my god.
But Ittle Dew 2, which, by the way, it took me a long time to get the name of Ittle Dew. Ittle Dew.
Oh, I didn't notice that, actually.
Yeah, it took me way longer than I want to admit. I was just like, it'll do. Oh,
yeah, I didn't get it.
It'll do. I'm giving it a buy it. It'll do too. Yes, it will definitely do.
Nice.
All right, next game to talk about is called Unlucky Mage, developed by Exe Create Incorporated, published by KEMCO. It released November 3rd on the Nintendo 3DS for $9.99. The various powers across the Adamantia continent, have long fought one with another. What the... English.
Yeah.
Have long fought one with another. That is what it says. I copy and paste. In an effort to gain supreme control over the vast regions of land, each ruler and monarch thinking of none but themselves and leeching mercilessly off the labor of those citizens within their borders. But that all begins to change when an untrusting young mage named Jasper, living isolated from society, finds himself involved in a chain of events that is sure to go down in history as the greatest story ever told. Because it's a KEMCO game, we, of course, had to get our friend Kris Taylor to cover this one, and Kris is joining us for this. So, Kris Taylor, how's Unlucky Mage?
It's pretty good. That's
okay, thanks. And that's...
I was just pulling up a picture you caught me unawares. Okay. So yeah, Unlucky Mage. It's the newest in the sort of X-Create. Have we figured out if it's X-Create or Exe Create?
I'd just say EXE.
EXE. Oh, yeah. That probably makes some sense.
I figure if it's an executable, an .exe, so...
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Whatever.
Sure. So, yeah, it's the newest in a JRPG series that I assume, actually, I didn't specifically research this one. I assume it came out for cell phones first and then was ported over by KEMCO and released. I think I might be correct in that.
That is their MO, yeah. So I would expect that.
Yeah. So it's got the like sort of 2D sprite based approach, no 3D capabilities whatsoever. If you've listened to the last, what was it, three games I reviewed?
Something like that.
I think they have four total now, actually, now that I'm thinking about it. So I must have done two of them so far. Well, it's I would say that there's definitely some incremental improvements. For one, the game looks nicer than I think the other games, which are, Infinite Dunamis and, Journey to Crisia, Alphadia. I believe that's the whole series. And, on top of that, what I've enjoyed the most about this particular title so far has been actually the story. I may have complained a little bit in the past of the stories being kind of generic, but this one has got a little bit more going for it. You got a mage, his name is Jasper, and he's sort of a loner, and he kind of gets pulled into all the events that sort of happen around him, which is, I suppose, why he is an unlucky mage. Like Journey to Crisia, the game kind of deals with sort of elements of like racism and things like that, in that he is a mage, and as a mage he's like separate from humans somehow. The game hasn't really gotten into great detail on that, and in fact he looks exactly like everyone else except that he wears a robe. So it's kind of like, apparently this is a world wherein people are racist against people in robes.
Sons of bitches.
I know. Why can't we all just get along? it has the same sort of interface, like for battles and things. You're on one side of the screen, enemies on the other side of the screen. What they've added in this time is that now you can actually sort of make these on-the-fly sort of formations for your party. And so, like, you can have a more aggressive stance, a more defensive stance, a stance more suitable for, like, using magic or distance weapons. And the game actually will increase and decrease certain stats and immunities based on where your people are standing. And so that kind of adds in this pretty cool element that I've never seen before of, like, getting your guys to stand in the right spot.
I think they had that in one of the other KEMCO titles. I remember something similar to that.
Yeah, I'm not too sure which one it was. I mean, in the other two that I haven't that I played, it wasn't like that really. But
well, KEMCO has released, I think, 75 different RPGs so far this year. So
yes, so 12 of those 75 feature the innovative formation system.
Hey, and they can keep churning them out because they're all good to me.
Oh, of course. Yeah. No, I've really enjoyed this one so far. The cool thing about it as well is that on top of directly affecting your stats and, like I said, your defenses and things like that, you actually get sort of team attacks that are triggered just by your main character. So, like, the rest of your team can still keep fighting if you use one of these attacks. But, you know, it is kind of costly. So you do kind of get a blow up the world sort of move that you get to bring all four of your characters into. So I always enjoy that. Like I said, the writing's pretty good. It's very heavy on story. Like, I think in, you know, the hours I played, it's like, I'm pretty sure most of it was spent scrolling through text at this point, but, the text is actually pretty interesting. The sense of humor is a little weird. There's a character called Sardonis, which would make you think he was like a sarcastic character because sardonic, something, I don't know. But
words.
He's just really overenthusiastic, and he tends to say things, and I'm quoting this as a line because I took a picture of it with my phone. Then just the opposite. Christelle is like a goddess whose bowels are filled with infinite charity towards others. That's the second time that he refers to the female character's bowels in a kind of biblical sense.
Every time we get you to do a KEMCO review, you always have some kind of insane line ready to tell us.
That's what I was pulling up at the beginning. Yeah, and, you know, God bless KEMCO. They keep bringing him to us, providing us with those bizarre lines.
I think that's my favorite part of getting you to review these games, is you always seem to find that one line in the game that just confuses the shit out of us.
It's because my bowels are filled with infinite charity toward others.
Could be filled with something else, so...
Yeah, I think it might be something else, actually. You know, got to cut this review short. Excuse me a second. So yeah, like apart from all that, like the improvements to the story, the weird incongruous dialogue, music's fantastic. Really love listening to it. Battle themes are actually particularly good on this. I'm really hoping that KEMCO starts actually releasing these soundtracks like separately. Like, you know how a lot of the guys do, like Renegade Kid's really good about that.
Yeah.
Like purchasing, just downloading the soundtrack and listening to it. I like that. The only other thing, and this has been a consistent thing about all of the games that they have, is that on the title screen you have the option to continue or load game, and I still haven't figured out what the continue thing does, because it always seems to put me back further in the past from when I last saved, so I always have to say load game. Yeah, I'm never sure what that option is all about, so that's a weird little complaint that I guess is just going to be in all these games.
Interesting.
So, yeah.
So, overall, what do you think?
Overall, I say if you've been eyeballing these KEMCO games that show up for, I think it's $9.99 on the eShop.
Yep.
This one is the best so far. I would say buy it.
Nice. So I will probably grab that when I get some Nintendo cash.
I think so, yeah. I would say, you know, Journey to Kresia is also a buy it. Again, I was a little weirded out by their animal people kind of thing. This has none of that, so that's kind of cool. I will say one of the characters does wear a hat with a feather in it, and I'm a little wary of that, but he seems otherwise okay.
Those feather hats. What are you going to do?
Well, it's if you took the hat, the feather out, it would look like a fedora, so I was very cautious about that at first. But I think it's actually a wide-brimmed hat, and that's okay.
Okay. That works.
Yeah. This is definitely a pivotal thing in my reviews, is one of the characters wearing a fedora.
I mean, you got to be wary of those, but otherwise, sounds good. Sounds like a good one.
Yeah, it's really good. I say buy it.
All right, sounds good. So thank you for that, Kris, and I'll be sure to get you back on next time we have a KEMCO game.
All right, thanks very much.
Next game to talk about is called Energy Cycle, developed and published by Sometimes You. This game is not out yet. It releases December 8th. So this one is still up in the future. It is going to release on Xbox One for $2.99. Energy Cycle, a new puzzle game from developers of Energy Balance. When you click each cell on the game field, it changes color and the colors adjacent cells horizontally and vertically. Your task is to bring all the cells to the same color. Sounds pretty easy, but try to do it. CJ, you played this one. What do you think?
Well, Energy Cycle is a new puzzle game that's been out on Steam for a while, actually. I had seen it multiple times, and in 2 weeks it sees its Xbox One release. Now, I quite like this game. It was simplistic and yet unique for the Xbox One marketplace. While I've seen these type of color matching games before, it has not been on Xbox One, as far as games I've played. The idea of the puzzle is to get every electricity orb to be the same color. The twist is that at any time you change the color of one orb, it changes any orbs that are connected to it in a line, either horizontally or vertically, or both. And you have to try to get every single one of them to be the same color. The board will be filled with odd colors, so you got to figure out, like, maybe change one that's horizontally above. Is that how horizontally works? Which one's which?
Horizontal is up and down. Or no, left and right. Vertical is up and right. Down.
See, I never get that. If you change horizon. One that's, like, horizontal.
The horizon. Exactly.
That's a good way to think about it. I've never heard that. Anyway.
I mean, it's not like it's in the word or anything.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you so much. If you change one that's horizontally, it will change that line only. But if you have one that's connecting horizontally and vertically at one point, if you change the one that's connecting both, it'll actually change both of those rows. So you have to figure out a way to get both of those rows to turn into the same color by changing the colors around. And overall, it was really challenging late in the game. While the first levels are kind of easy, you get into it and all of a sudden it gets really difficult, and you're spending 15 minutes on a single level, possibly. I don't know if you played through the entire game, Joe, but...
Yes, I have.
It got challenging.
Yeah, the game is definitely... the way it's meant to be played, it is not an easy game. Like, it's not meant to be easy, but achievement whores are going to love the fuck out of this game, because if you use a guide on Steam, you can get 1,000 achievement points in about 20-25 minutes.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up later.
But if you're if you're playing it the right way...
Oh, it's going to take a couple hours.
It is a legitimately tough, difficult... and worthwhile game, especially for fucking $3. God damn.
There are 28 story mode puzzles that are always the same. So every time you play that level, it'll always be the same. And once you've beaten it, there isn't much replay value to it. You can go for less clicks, as the game does track that. Although I wish it was more obvious, and perhaps on the puzzle select screen, rather than having to go back to the main menu and look at the credits / stats.
Yeah.
I would prefer if I could actually just look and see at each level, like, how many clicks I've gotten. There's also two other modes in the game, a time attack mode that puts you against the clock and gives you random puzzles to go through before you run out of time. Each time you beat a puzzle, time is added to the clock, and infinity play, which I believe is the same thing as time attack, if I remember right, just without the stress of a timer. The game's background looks nice and isn't too distracting from the puzzles, and the music is good, but gets really repetitive because I believe it's the same track throughout the entire game. The biggest crowd this game will draw in is Achievement Hunters. Honestly, the game could be completed in 10 to 20 minutes using a guide on Steam. Now, of course, I'll say this right now. I did not use a guide to keep this review pure.
Good.
Because if you're reviewing a game, and I've seen too many people on there doing this, if you're reviewing a game and you use a guide, you're an asshole.
Yeah, pretty much.
You're not playing the game the way it's supposed to be played. The game isn't too difficult to play on, but gets progressively harder.
What did I do? That wasn't fair.
It took me a couple hours to do it legit, but with some puzzles seeming very lucky, with low number counts and others, well, I don't want to talk about it. I got 199 clicks on puzzle 6.
Nice.
That was hard. Another thing that'll draw in that crowd in specific is the super low price of $2.99. This will be the next Q-bot amongst Achievement Hunters.
Oh, perhaps definitely.
Perhaps even making more sales than actual puzzle fans themselves.
Yeah, I can see that.
I mean, that's the case with Q-bot. Like, I definitely believe that game has sold way more towards Achievement Hunters than it has puzzle fans. Because there are people out there that if a game gets released with easy achievements, they'll buy it right away and play it, especially mm-hmm. this cheap. This cheap is really great. I have to give this game a buy. It's too cheap to give anything else. And the game is pretty good for the price, too. It's not like you're just buying a game that's like fair. This is a good price for this game.
Yeah, I fully agree. For $3, there's a lot of game there to play for the people who want to actually enjoy the game. If you're an achievement whore, it's cheap enough and quick enough that you're definitely going to buy it no matter what we say, because I'm sure it is already growing in legend amongst the achievement whoring community that they can get 1,000 achievement points in 20 minutes.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah, it is. But hey, that's a smart way to market a game.
Yeah. And for $3, fuck yes.
Fuck it, why not?
There you go.
There's no other rating for this game. Like, it's a
fuck
good
it, why
game
not?
At a cheap price.
Pretty much.
I mean, I guess. Fuck it, why not? Is
normally that's why that exists.
Weird.
That's exactly
no, it's normally
why.
Weird, though.
No, like, no. Not just fuck cheap. It. Fuck it, why not is specifically reserved for cheap games.
See, I like to think fuck it, why not is in between try it and buy it, where it's something that normally you wouldn't buy, but it's cheap enough that you're like, fuck it, why not? Exactly. Where this is a game where it deserves a buy it.
Yeah, it's okay. Not bad enough to be weird. It's a good okay. game.
Yeah. Makes sense?
I got it.
Our show is stupid. Yes. One more and then we'll get to you, Kris, just because I'm trying to space these out to give my voice a rest.
Sure.
Next game to talk about is called Clouds in Sheep 2, developed by Handy Games, published by Head Up Games, released October 24th on Steam for $99, and it releases on Xbox One November 18th. In this eagerly anticipated sequel of the game Clouds in Sheep, the cute sheep are finally on the loose again. Solve countless quests and fulfill your woolly friend's needs. Our friend Jacob, aka Sweatpants from the early days, wrote in his review for this one. He says, Clouds and Sheep 2 by Handy Games is a sequel to a sheep-raising game that I had never heard of until Joe gave me a code for this and said, you need to review this, followed later by, you should have reviewed this last week. God, I hate you and everything you stand for. So I reviewed it. Or will, because Joe's lovingly reading this now, hating every second of having to read my words. Anyway, Clouds and Sheep 2 starts you off in a simple barnyard where the game explains how different mechanics work and how to make things happen. There's a huge menu bar to your left that is filled with a daunting amount of options for what is supposed to be a game seemingly for kids, filled with different things you can do with your sheep, such as what color you want their wool to be, things you can buy for them, etc. It's a simulation game with the option to buy things, which is a welcome change for me, but it didn't make the gameplay any better. The game tries to explain how things work, but it doesn't actually do a good job job of it, giving you simple animations and text, and then expecting you to figure out the rest on your own. The help documents within the game are worse, providing what feels like an even shorter animation. After nailing down some of the gameplay mechanics, it whisks you away to a different setting, and oh no, you'd better get a campfire going before nightfall so your sheep doesn't freeze to death. Oh, and you don't have enough supplies, and we aren't going to explain how to get a campfire, so have fun with that. Of course, you can bring one of your sheep back from the dead for a price, but of course there's no health bar to explain who's dying, just little thought bubbles that explain what the sheep wants. I know the game is aimed at kids, but I feel like there's really too much at once in the game, and your kid is going to end up with some dead sheep before being ready for the next thing. There are also quests that need to be completed, allowing your sheep to complete their goals in life, like getting a really good bounce on a trampoline, but of course the game doesn't explain how to make this happen, and the quest lines just pile up along with everything else you need to do in the barnyard. I had mentioned earlier about customizing your sheep, but much like everything else, it doesn't get explained. One of the early quests makes you put a baseball cap on your sheep. Fair enough, plenty of simulation games allow you to customize your characters. But then something happened after I clicked on my sheep, and suddenly the baseball cap disappeared. How do I put it back on? Is it gone for good? Do I seriously have to earn enough currency to put another hat back on that specific sheep? Don't know, because the game didn't explain that. Clouds and Sheep 2 has some fun ideas to it, but it's too chaotic and expansive for its own good. When it is something that is aimed at children, the makers need to slow down introducing gameplay mechanics and working on better ways to help gamers understand what they're working with and how one thing affects another. Yeah, I put some time into it on Steam, and it just seemed to fire new mechanics at you constantly without letting you really get adjusted to things.
Okay. So
all right.
I mean, I really enjoyed the other games that we've covered from Handy Games so far, but this one, it seems too busy and too much to do. I'm going to assume that they're expecting you to have played the first one if they're not really explaining a lot of the mechanics that well in game. So it very much might be one of those things where, you know, we've covered games in the past that are kind of like direct sequels that start with the assumption that you've played the first one. And
all right,
considering,
I mean, that's not a great idea when it's the first on the consoles.
Exactly. So I know Dreamle's Dream Quest on the Xbox One, when we covered that one, the second game on it was the second game to release, but it was the first one on Xbox One, and that was another game that seemingly started off with the assumption that you played the first one. And I think that could be harmful to some games. Like, if no one's ever played the first Clouds and Sheep and there's a lot more tutorial to that game, you might be missing out on a lot. I haven't played the Xbox One version, so it's very possible that that version of the game has more tutorial to it, and it's just the Steam version that kind of starts with the assumption that you've played the first one.
I mean, sounding from the review he gave, did he do it on Steam as well, or did he do it on Xbox?
Steam.
Oh, okay.
Because Jacob doesn't have an Xbox One.
Oh, I didn't know that about Jacob.
Yeah. Although he just ordered Disney Infinity 3.0 on Xbox One from Best Buy because they had it for like $6.
Oh, so I guess he's just planning to get one eventually?
Yeah. I know for Mass Effect.
Oh, that would make sense. Although you could play that on PC.
Yeah.
So
he's a console guy overall. But he didn't really give it an official verdict, but I can kind of assume he's leaning towards the deny it.
Yeah, that's what it felt like.
I can kind of understand where he's coming from. I don't know how the Xbox One version of the game plays. Although I think this is something that Handy Games could easily update by adding some more, you know, just a smidge more hand-holding to the game, or at least slowing down the introduction of new elements. Next week, we will have a giveaway for the game, so it's very possible that someone could win the game and enjoy the fuck out of it, because it's visually, it is a cute, adorable game. It's got some goofy-ass achievements in it, like bouncing a sheep on a trampoline 100 times. But, you know, I've loved Handy Games' other titles, and I think this one has a lot of potential as long as they ease up on how quickly they try to shove you through the game.
All right.
Make sense? Any questions?
No. I mean, I listening to the review, it sounded like he was leaning towards a deny it.
Yeah. Kris, any thoughts?
Nope, none here.
Kris is just like, what do you expect?
Kris is just like, just let me review my fucking game because I got shit to do. Speaking of, next game to talk about is called Mark McMorris Infinite Air, developed by HB Studios, published by Maximum Games, released October 25th for $49.99, which is the equivalent of 10 genital joustings. Join pro snowboarder Mark McMorris and an elite crew of riders in a vast open-world snowboarding experience. Compete in authentic events, drop in on any mountain peak by helicopter, and design your own snow parks to shred with the world editor. Kris, you put some time into this. I put a little bit in as well last night, but let's hear your thoughts on the game.
Oh, you ended up picking it up?
Yeah, I found it cheap, so...
I'm curious, just before we get into it, how cheap were you able to get it for?
Like $39.99.
Okay, so when I found out the price of this and I went into it and I started playing it a little bit, like, obviously I have to compare it slightly to the game that I did last week, which was Snow, correct?
Yep. Yeah.
Okay, so going from Snow to this, everybody was kind of saying that, like, from what I had heard, they were comparing it to Skate, but just a snowboarding version of Skate. The closest that I have been able to play of a game that was close to a snowboarding version of Skate was Amped, and obviously Amped being much older. I went into this with the mentality of, oh, maybe this will be like Amped. And I'm talking, I think it might have been the first one that I'm thinking of. Maybe the first or the second. I don't know if I ever played the third. But I'm talking like original Xbox.
Yeah.
I was kind of expecting it to at least be on that level when it came to like customizability of your character. I was pretty underwhelmed with the character customization. I mean, it gives you the option of having a custom character, but there's really not that much to unlock for them. So I will say that the level design in this one is much better than Snow. Snow is pretty much just like and this is kind of designed in some ways too, where it's just an open mountain, you get dropped in. It's got that free roam kind of element to it, but I think the design is a little bit better in this one. There's like some of the park sections seem to make a little bit more sense. The ability of being able to create your own, like the terrain editor, I think that's really, really cool. It's very difficult for me to really strongly recommend it for the price. I feel like there should be a little bit more content with it at that price. I mean, the fact that you can do the whole track editor, I feel like adds a little bit of extra longevity to it. I didn't really mess around with downloading other people's courses. I don't know if you did, Joe.
A bit, yeah.
Okay. How much replayability do you feel like that? I'm sure it adds a lot more.
I think replayability for this game is off the charts. It's made by the same people who made the Golf Club, which allowed you to create your own courses.
Yeah.
So in essence, as long as people are making mountains and making courses and carving routes and uploading their runs, there is basically infinite replayability to the game.
Now, the only thing that I kind of struggled with is some of the controls. Like, now, obviously, with Skate being backwards compatible, I started playing Skate a lot more again.
Yeah, so I think you're kind of at a disadvantage of reviewing this one because so many people have compared it to Skate, and you have been playing Skate. So.
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm coming to this game with more of a background from that. And... I mean, they're obviously two completely different kind of things. I think even just the way that you do your rotations and your flips and stuff, like doing the barrel roll, the way that you have to kind of approach it was kind of goofy to me, and the way that you kind of have to wind up, which I like it. It's, you know, it's a little more innovative, but trying to get the accuracy is just like it's a lot of guesswork.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't know if you felt that way, but I like playing games like that with the ability of going, I want to do this trick, and I want to do it consistently every single time.
Yeah, a lot of times for me, it seemed like I'm coming up to a ramp. Let me just hold jump in a direction, let go, and
hope for the best.
Hope for the best. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like, and I think that was one thing for me that just kind of discouraged me from wanting to play it more. Like, it's not, I know it's probably coming off that I really don't like this game. It's not bad. I just don't know if it's good enough for me to like really give it a hearty recommend. I would probably end up going and leaning towards try it, just because, like, I don't know, coming from a game like Skate, like, I guess I'm a little bit spoiled when it comes to Skate 3.
Yeah,
because like the park editor is fantastic in that, like the controls in a game like this, I feel like the controls are going to make or break the game. And like you said, like coming up to a jump and just kind of hoping for the best, like I don't like that.
No, I agree. I think this is a game that, as long as you spent enough time and got comfortable enough with it, you can eventually get to the point where you're doing the tricks you want. But I think that requires a massive time investment. I think it is, I don't want to come off like it's negative, but I think it's decent enough that even beginners, as long as they're hitting shit, they could eventually pull off some crazy looking tricks and feel like they did something really awesome.
Oh yeah.
But
yeah,
there's going to be a lot of moments. There's going to be a lot of times where you go up in the air and you just grab, you know, you grab the board and do nothing else. And you're like, what the, why isn't he rotating? Why isn't he flipping? Right. And you're going to wipe out a lot as well. I think it is a game that you could eventually master. And given how much content is that there's the potential for in the game, I think the people who really get into this game can lose themselves in it for months.
Sure, sure. And even at nothing else, being able to just kind of like cruise down a mountain is cool. Like, that's not a bad thing. I like being able to do that. It's just, I kind of wish that there was a little bit more, like, I just wish that there was a little bit more, I guess. I kind of felt like,
did you go through the circuits? Because they do have the campaign circuits in the game. Normally,
yeah, I was messing around with it a bit.
Yeah, I bit more in terms of like the single player content in the, like, the not single player, but just like the created, like the campaign stuff.
Yeah,
I wish there was more to that, but I think that there's sufficient to at least get you comfortable with the game. And you know, the big draw to this game is clearly the mountain creation, the customization, and just sharing and playing other people's levels. I think it's, you have to look at it more as like, you have to look at it like this is more Golf Club than Tiger Woods, where it's a game that has a handful of pre-made content, but it's more about creating and sharing stuff than it is about, you know, having set stuff already made for you.
Well, and you know, and I can appreciate that, but the issue that I always end up coming to when it comes to titles that take on that mentality is, you know, if you're gonna justify having like a I don't want to say premium price tag, because it is slightly lower, but quasi semi premium price tag on a game that, you know, for all intents and purposes, when it comes to content, is slightly lacking as far as what you're providing.
Yeah.
Like, if you're kind of more so riding on the backs of hoping that somebody else will create more content for it to have that longevity, like, that's kind of a bummer.
I can understand that.
that was one of the things that kind of bummed me out with the newer Trials games, because a lot of them, like when it first started out, they didn't really incorporate that too heavily. Like, it was there, but they didn't incorporate it so heavily to the fact that you felt like you got slightly gypped with the single player experience. You know what I mean?
I actually completely disagree with you with the Trials bit, but you know.
Well, they ended up going.
I put 250 hours in that game.
Oh, I love Trials. Don't get me wrong, I love Trials. It's one of my favorite games. But again, I wish that it's one of those franchises that, you know, they started, you know, relying a little bit more heavily on their community to make that outstanding content as opposed to providing it themselves. They did later on with DLC and stuff like that, which is all it's completely possible with something like this. I don't know what the DLC plans are for this game, but
Golf Club, where the developers, they would just create new courses and put them online for people to download. Like Golf Club didn't really have paid DLC. It was just they made stuff and shared it like any other person would.
Right.
So it's very possible we see that happen. Who knows? I think this game may have gotten a buy it if it were $40 instead of $50.
I have to say that I would have given it a buy it at $30.
Understand. I mean, I think that there is a lot of content there. Based on my time with the beta, I think it's better than Steep so far, and I definitely prefer it over Snow.
Unfortunately,
and I personally definitely prefer this over Snow, but Snow is still an open beta. So I think of the three snowboarding games that are going to be available this year, this is definitely the one to keep your eyes on. If you're worried about it, Gamefly, but the critique is still definitely there that there is not much pre-made content there for the $50, but there is an insane amount of potential there for people who are
creative. Yeah, there's potential. There is. Again, I kind of wish that the control scheme made a little bit more sense with consistency, but you know, I feel like
it hurt my fingers too with like holding the triggers to jump, releasing, but still holding directions.
The time investment that it would take to really put into this game to make sure that you're, you know, performing it the way that you would want to, it's pretty steep.
Yeah. I still think it's worth checking out in the long run. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm gonna end with a try it.
I agree.
But you know, who knows? If you can get it at like a really cheap, like I would say maybe like $30.
And who knows, with Black Friday, you might see it cheap enough out there. So
yeah, that's what I'm saying. If you can get it relatively cheap, and you're really having to struggle of trying to find other stuff that you'd be interested in, consider it. You know,
it's definitely at least worth keeping an eye on if you're looking for a snowboarding game. I think this is probably the best of the ones out right now.
Of the ones that I've played so far, I agree.
Cool. All right, we got three games left. Kris, are you going to bounce or did you want to hang out
for those three? I still haven't had an opportunity to do dinner.
All right, and it's already 11 o'clock.
So I'm going to go do that.
See All right, you. Take it easy, Kris.
All right, see you guys.
See you.
Bye.
Yep, three more games to talk about. Next one is going to be Lantern.
Develop Trials. Fucking leave.
Lantern, developed by Storm in a Teacup, published by 1C Company, released November 15th on Steam for $6.99 and includes support for Oculus Rift and Vive. Be the wind and guide a gentle lantern that spreads the powerful message of everlasting love by bringing life and color back to the world around you. Lantern is a relaxing game experience full of positive emotions. Uneaten Lake sent in a review for this one. So let us see what he has to say here. Lantern is a relaxing adventure game with a VR mode developed by Storm in a Teacup and published by 1C. Current price is $6.99 on Steam. And Storm in a Teacup is the company that brought you Nero and Enki. In Lantern, you fly a Chinese lantern around the level, coloring anything you get close to. There's some sort of story where there's a woman whose sadness caused all the color to drain from the world. It's your duty to fly this lantern around and return the color to the world. The gameplay is similar to that of the game Flower that was released on PS3 a few years back. There are no checkpoints within the four levels, so make sure you have 30 minutes to an hour to finish a level. Once you finish a level, you can either replay that level or move on to the next. Each level is named after a different season, summer, autumn, winter, spring, and has you doing the same thing in each level. Fly around, color objects, move on. Thankfully, the levels are different enough to keep the game enjoyable. The videos for this game looked amazing, and the thought of being able to play in VR inside this game's world was something I was really looking forward to. Unfortunately, the game's VR mode is less than stellar. I was glad to see that others were having issues with the VR mode as well. The problem with the VR mode stems from the camera angle and the speed at which it refreshes on your headset. If a game is too slow to render, you will typically give up, will typically end up giving the user motion sickness. Lantern unfortunately suffers from this problem. I tried playing the game one day and was sick to my stomach the rest of the day. Giving the game a fair chance, I figured maybe it was something I ate that made me feel bad. 2 days later, I tried the VR mode again. I made it just a bit past the first section before I had to stop again and was again struck with an ill feeling for most of the day. One cool aspect of the VR mode was that the videos at the start of the level are played on a screen that I can only describe as feeling like I was floating in front of a huge IMAX screen. Thankfully, the game isn't a VR-only title, or maybe it's unfortunately that it feels like the VR mode was added late to the game in hopes to increase sales. Either way, there is a non-VR mode, which is more than enjoyable. Hopefully, this isn't going to be a trend where games end up having a tacked-on VR experience when the game doesn't really need it. In both the VR and regular version, you use a controller to fly around. For some reason, the controls never quite fit what I wanted to do. I think a simple tweak in how you control the lantern would make this game a lot easier to get into. I think a lot of gamers are accustomed to using the right joystick to change the viewpoint of the camera and the left to move. In Lantern, you only use the left stick and the A button to move forward. I also had a few issues with the game not launching in regular mode unless my computer was completely disconnected from my Vive. I found a few bugs as well in the winter level that had me flying outside the world, as well as getting stuck in a tunnel that wasn't allowing me to progress in the game. There are hidden items and collectibles that you can find that will give you achievements and such. This will add some replayability to the game. Unfortunately, I wouldn't recommend this game in its current state if you were looking to just add it to your VR library. I would give Lantern a buy it if you are looking for a relaxing, non-VR game to play, even with some of the bugs I found. If you're looking to only play this game in VR, I have to say deny it until there's some sort of update that fixes the frame rate in the VR mode.
All right, so not great VR game, but great game.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Especially for $6.99. So.
Yeah, that is a good price. Cheap.
And I enjoyed Flower on the PS3, so it sounds good. And he did mention this to me on Twitter earlier. He wanted to point out that the soundtrack in the game is fantastic, and he hopes that they release it for sale. Because he was hoping that we could actually play it on the show, but I need to be able to get it to play it.
But, true, and you already have like 60 other songs to play today.
Yeah, we're going to play some Ittle Dew and Kris.
God, I wasn't even here for that conversation because I had to go to the bathroom, but
yeah,
that was interesting.
Lantern sounds pretty cool. I hope that eventually makes it to console, maybe not PSVR, but I guess we'll see.
You can keep the PSVR stuff. I don't want
it. If they fix the VR, I'm happy to check it out, but if people who don't normally get motion sick playing the game are getting motion sick, they got to tweak the VR stuff.
Yeah, because then you'll just die.
Yeah, I might. My face might just explode. Next game to talk about is called Wheels of Aurelia, developed by Santa Ragione, published by Mixbag Publishing, released November 18th on Xbox One and I believe other platforms for $9.99. A narrative road trip game set in the roaring Italian 70s. It tells the story of Lella, a restless woman driving on the roads of the western coast of Italy. CJ, you covered this one. What did you think of it?
Well, I gotta make a quick correction there. This game was already actually available on PlayStation 4 and PC, and it's just come to Xbox One. So this
jazzy.
That's the only release this time. It is not on other platforms, or not releasing right now.
Okay, well, it's already available on other platforms.
Yes, exactly.
Don't you dare correct me again, you son of a
fucking
bitch.
Story, right? I wouldn't have to if you were correct about it.
I will cut you. Anyway. I will fucking cut you.
Wheels of Aurelia is a unique narrative story game where you play as Lila, or is it Lella?
Lila,
I think. You know, not a normal name, but whatever. Futurama.
Lella, Bella Lella.
Who was on a road trip with her friend in 1978. They're going from Rome, which is their home, to France. And along the way, they meet interesting new people who are hitchhiking. The gameplay is pretty unique. On a normal basis, you're simply selecting responses for your character to say, but in certain stories, there are racing sequences. Yes, that's right. This game turns into a top-down racing game. The controlling of the car is simple enough and well done. You simply press A to boost and turn with the left stick, and you can also boost and turn outside of races to speed things up if you like. If you press nothing, your car will just automatically drive at a normal pace and make turns on its own. So kind of like cruise control, but it actually turns on its own as well. The story is interesting, but weirdly handled and very short. There are 16 endings to the story, all of which are unlocked by doing things differently. It is a little hard to review the game based on the fact that it's strong narrative focus, and I don't want to get too much into the stories. I'd say the stories, honestly. There's even an achievement for finishing the game in 15 minutes, and every single person that's played through one story has gotten that achievement.
Yeah, I've heard that the game is fairly short for a playthrough, but because there's so many different endings, it encourages you to replay it quite a bit.
That's the appeal to this game, is the more replayability, trying to find out everything that happens in the game. I do wish that the game had some changes or different prompts at the beginning of the game, because the game always starts the same way, and it gets really repetitive as you're trying to discover all the endings. The art style is done very well. I really like the way it looks. It feels like what I imagine a 1970s environment would look like, reminding me sort of GTA Vice City, in a way. Just the way everything looked. Except, you know, not killing people. I think.
Cool.
I haven't done every single ending, so, I mean, maybe you kill people. Who knows? Another awesome thing about the game is the music. It sounds great. I really love it, and that is quite important, considering there's no voice acting in the game, and it all just feels so like the 70s as I would imagine it. I was not born in the 70s, obviously.
Shocking.
Yeah, I mean, really. This
you
game
were born
is not
in
for
2008.
That is not true at all. I don't even sound like I was born in 2008, because then I would be 8 years old, and I would sound like this. And that's not good for anybody. This game isn't for everybody. If you're looking for a more relaxing, narrative-focused game, this is for you. But if you're looking for a game with action or like a lot going on, you're not really going to find that here. This is a relaxing game to just play when you want to. Play something really great, pick up and play game, where if you're a gamer with very limited time, pick this up, play it 20 minutes, put it down, and you beat a whole playthrough.
Nice.
Now I did foreshadow in an earlier review that you said that an achievement was broken in your game. This game also has that issue. There is currently an unobtainable achievement. And I had to do some research, because the way they went with the descriptions is some of the achievements don't actually have a proper description, but instead something just like weird. And this one was one of those games that had that, where it was like the achievement was called Gorilla, and it says "Nice car, sweetie." What does that mean? Nobody knows. Yeah. So I had to do a little bit of research, and I found the PlayStation achievement list, and which determines that that achievement is the platinum trophy on Xbox One, except not really platinum. And so that's how I determined that it was glitched, because there are people who have unlocked every achievement except that one. And if that is the platinum, that means that that achievement cannot be obtained as right now.
Interesting.
Huh. So if that bothers you, there's another thing that's kind of like, eh. But if you're not really a horror of achievements, then eh, it won't matter to you.
Even for someone who doesn't care about achievements, if the last achievement is the achievement for getting all other achievements and you don't get that achievement, that would piss me off.
I suppose so, because at this point you spent all the effort to do everything else. But on the bright side, it means if a fix does come, you just launch up the game and it'll unlock for you. You don't actually have to do anything outside of that.
Hopefully.
Hopefully they do fix it. I would love to see them make this so that it's not glitched anymore and everybody can just complete it and have a good time.
Yeah.
But hey, there's 16 endings. You got plenty of time. Hopefully they patch it while you're playing through every single ending. Overall, I'd say try it. It's not for everybody, but for some, this game will be very enjoyable.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are going to be annoyed at the fact that they bought this game expecting, like, a racing title, and for the most part, it's not.
I didn't know that there was racing in it. That actually surprised me. I thought it was just a narrative game.
Yeah, that surprised me, too. Like,
it turned into a top-down racing game, and I was just like, whoa, where did this come from?
Interesting.
And the racing's good.
It's definitely on my radar when it comes out, so I just need
which is tomorrow as of the recording, probably already out by the time this episode comes out.
Hell, it might be out now for all I know, or it's an hour away.
That's true.
There's so much shit coming out too. God damn. One last game to talk about. Destroy All Humans, originally developed by Pandemic Games, ported and published by THQ Nordic. It released November 3rd on the PlayStation 4 for $19.99. This is your chance to experience the other side of an alien invasion. Take on the role of alien Cryptosporidium. Oh, crypto? Oh my god. That's crypto, like Kreptor.
I did not put that together because I don't call myself that.
And terrorize the people of Earth to harvest their DNA in the most brazen action adventure you've ever played. Take over all of humanity using a variety of alien weaponry on land or in the air. This is going to be a review that's more annoyed with Sony, because this, I didn't realize this at first, this is a PS2 classic. Right. When it was announced and when it came out, they weren't very clear in the fact that this was just another one of their PS2 classics with, you know, the improved resolution and trophy support. And it's not a full-on remaster. This is,
right.
Yeah, this, I didn't know that. I thought this was I wouldn't say a full-on remaster, but I thought it was a quote-unquote remaster as opposed to just one of the up-resed PS2 classics. And I didn't know, like, even the listing on the store for the game on the PSN store, it doesn't mention it. The first time I realized this was a PS2 classic was when I started the game. It showed the splash screen, and then it showed the PS2 startup screen.
Yeah, that's a pretty big giveaway.
Yeah, I had no idea until then. The game
doesn't surprise me too much, though.
Yeah, the game, for the most part, it suffers from the same issues that many of the PS2 classics have. The gameplay looks decent enough. I think I've seen some of the PS2 classics that have better textures and, you know, better looking visuals with how they've been spruced up. This one is serviceable. It's decent enough. It still, for the most part, it's going to look like a PS2 game for the most part. But it looks decent enough. It's not overly blurry or anything like that. Any of the cutscenes or video clips are grainy and ugly. And it's the same problem with every PS2 classic, because they'll improve the textures and the actual gameplay, but they never touch the videos, which they need to fucking do something about this. I shouldn't, you know, the video shouldn't look like a 480i real video from the early days of the internet blown up onto a 60-inch screen. It just shouldn't...
Right. I mean, that would just take you out of it, really. It's just like, the game looks nice, and then you get to do the crap cutscene again.
Yeah, you know, when we reviewed Rise of the Kasai, or one of those games, I had the same issue, where the cutscenes look like dog shit, but the gameplay looks good. You know,
similar with, you reviewed that Marvel Ultimate Alliance games. Even though it's not the same deal, it's still... not up-resing or making the cutscenes look any better.
The Ultimate Alliance ones look good enough because they were still last-gen.
Yeah, they're not old as shit.
Like these PS2 classics, because I have a handful of the PS2 classics, anything that's done in-game engine looks fine because it's game engine, but any of the pre-rendered video cutscenes look terrible. And I wish that when they were recompiling these games or whatever else, they would include a higher resolution or a higher quality video for those cutscenes, because they look terrible. It is so jarring and ugly to see, you know, a 4:3 aspect ratio that's incredibly pixely and blocky and low resolution, and then you cut to a widescreen gameplay that's crisp and clear.
Yeah,
I
imagine.
It bugs the shit out of me, especially because for the most part, this is a premium priced PS2 classic. A lot of them come out at $10. A handful are $14.99. I think the only other ones that were $20 were Grand Theft Auto, and this one is $19.99. So I wasn't expecting this to be a PS2 classic. I was expecting this to be like just a slightly remastered version of the PS2 game. And I was let down by that. I really was.
I think it would have been better if it was, but
gameplay wise,
cost more money.
Yeah, I got to be fair. Gameplay wise, the game is still fun. It's still a game from 2005, but it's still an enjoyable game. All the problems that plagued the game from back then, like poor draw distance, are still going to be an issue here. So even when you're just exploring, trying to find the collectibles, you might not see them until you're like just about there, because the draw distance is so bad in this game. For 2005, it's fairly impressive, you know, the larger world and so much shit going on. The fact that fairly seamlessly you can go from on foot to up in your flying saucer and shooting shit from there. But for game 11 years later, it doesn't hold up the way it should. I would love to see THQ bring the game, I don't remember what the name of it, but there was a Destroy All Humans on PS3 and Xbox 360 that...
Path of Furon?
Yeah, there you go, Path of Furon, that was re-released after Nordic bought the THQ licenses. They re-released the title under Nordic Games. I would love to see them either give that a quote-unquote remaster on current gen, or at least give us that one as a backward-compatible title on Xbox One.
That'd be awesome.
Because it's not an 11-year-old game. Some of the games that are on the PS2 Classic service, they hold up fairly well over time. I think Destroy All Humans didn't hold up as well as other ones. For the game at the time, it was a fantastic, awesome game. It just doesn't hold up as well as it does. If you could find it on sale, it might be worth picking up to check out the origins of the game, the earlier goofy humor in the game, like giving people fucking anal probes until their brains explode out. For the most part, I got to give it a deny it. Wait for a price drop. It's just, it didn't age as well. And the fact that Sony isn't very clear on which games are PS2 classics and which ones aren't, they need to fix that. Because I think a lot of people are going to buy this expecting it to be something better than what it is.
Right. I would love to see them just do like a collection, do 1, 2 and Path of Furon for the newer gen systems.
Yeah.
I think that would be great.
At the very least, fix the fucking videos in the game.
Yeah, I would say it would be nice to see if like they just remade it from the ground up to see what it would look like now.
Yeah.
That would be great. But
The problem is those...
they'd have to be demand for it.
You know, the early game was made by Pandemic, and they're gone.
Right.
So, you know, the studio can't just remake the original game, but I don't know. If you're dying to play Destroy All Humans.
Yeah, it would have to be like a lot of.
Yeah. If you're dying to play Destroy All Humans on current gen, this is probably the only way to do it, but just keep in mind, you're playing an 11-year-old game that didn't age as well as some of the other PS2 classics. But I mean, it's still fun though. So if you find it cheaper, it's worth picking up. I know Sony has a 10-year or a 15-year, well, I don't know, some kind of anniversary sale going on right now where they have a bunch of PS2 classics down to like $5 or something. If they ever do that and Destroy All Humans is down to like 5 or 10, it's worth checking out. But at $20 for the premium price of this one, I don't think it's worth it.
All right. Fair enough.
But yeah, those are the games this episode. I'd say, unfortunately, it looks like one of our lesser weeks.
Yeah, did
no
there
really.
There was only like one or two buy-ins.
I think the standout title of the week is definitely Ittle Dew.
Yeah,
although next week should be pretty goddamn good.
Oh, I'm so excited for next week.
Coming up, you're going to be talking about next week on the show. You're going to be talking about Planet Coaster.
Yep, and I loved Roller Coaster Tycoon games as a kid.
And I know Planet Coaster's been getting some pretty good reviews so far. We're also going to have reviews coming up for Darksiders War Mastered Edition, Silence, The Whispered World 2,
shit.
And get this, Killing Floor 2 on PlayStation 4.
What on PlayStation 4?
Killing Floor 2.
Oh fuck, man, dude, that's awesome.
Yeah,
I like the original Killing Floor. I played it on PC a shit ton,
so I am excited to check that one out. And I believe we're also going to be getting another PSVR game on the show next week with Robinson from Crytek that just came out.
That reminds me, we didn't get any PSVR games this week.
Yeah, it kind of like hit a lull. So it seems a lot of people are saying that the honeymoon for PSVR is over. I know Eagle Flight and Robinson the Journey just came out, and we should be talking about Robinson next week on the show, as long as I get enough time into it. But yeah, should be a good show next week. But CJ, you got any final words?
I didn't prepare for this.
start playing a little bit of multiplayer, playing some TF2. What are we doing now? Why are we building servers? That's what I'm going to do. Actually, I'm just going to go to the server gallery and see if I can do some more time. I'm going to try to hold on. I love you. Bye, are you? I'm going to see if I can do some more time. I'm going to hold on. There we go.